Guten Morgen, bonjour, Falsche, Hodvon, welcome. As we join for this time of worship over the internet and through our CD ministry. The excitement and the opportunity of broadcasting to you is that our congregation at this time comes from many different places. And we trust that as we join from different places, we'll unite in our worship to Almighty God. A few announcements about our ongoing ministry. We have a time of youth worship, which goes out on Sunday evenings, and that's suited towards teens and 20s. On Wednesday night at 8 p.m, we have midweek Bible study, and currently we're working through the letter of Titus. And following midweek, then at 8:45 on Wednesday night, we also have a Zoom prayer meeting. So if you want to be part of that, please get in touch with me using the details at the end of this worship, and I'll send you the necessary codes. On Thursdays at 1:10, we have our weekly business lunchtime talk, putting the Bible back into business. As I'm sure you're well aware, the ministry of our church continues using different methods, and we continue to encourage you to support our ministry, both prayerfully and financially. And details are available at the end of this broadcast in how you can send in your offering. Today, we're coming to think about the crazy life of Joseph, tricky Tamar. One of our elders will now read from Genesis chapter 38 and it's verses 12 to 19. And these verses give us some insight into tricky Tamar. We encourage you to stay with us as we learn about Joseph's family and indeed catch glimpses of our own.
After a long time, Judah's wife, the daughter of Shua, died. When Judah had recovered from his grief, he went up to Timnah to the men who were shearing his sheep, and his friend Hira, the Adullamite, went with him. When Tamar was told, "Your father-in-law is on his way to Timnah to shear his sheep," she took off her widow's clothes, covered herself with a veil to disguise herself, and then sat down at the entrance to Enaim, which is on the road to Timnah. For she saw that Lo Shelah had now grown up, she had not been given to him as his wife. When Judah saw her, he thought she was a prostitute, for she had covered her face. Not realizing that she was his daughter-in-law, he went over to her by the roadside and said, "Come now, let me sleep with you." "And what will you give me to sleep with you?" she asked. "I'll send you a young goat from my flock," he said. "Will you give me something as a pledge until you send it?" she asked. He said, "What pledge should I give you?" "Your seal and its cord and the staff in your hand," she answered. So he gave her to her and slept with her, and she became pregnant by him. After she left, she took off her veil and put on her widow's clothes again.
Let's still our hearts before Almighty God in prayer. Let's pray. Most generous and Heavenly Father, we are ashamed of the sins that we have committed against you and against those that we know and love. We're not perfect, and we each have our pet sins that we cuddle and allow to thrive in our own tender care. Forgive us, we pray, in the name of Jesus, for the sins that we have committed. Help us to look to him, the one who provides for our salvation, the one who offers us eternal hope. Holy Spirit, we ask that you would strengthen us so that we may be able to resist the sins that the devil uses to trick us into disobedience to our Almighty God. And so, Heavenly Father, we turn to you and ask that you would unite us in an attitude of worship, that we would remember that we are gathered before the one who has created the universe. We are gathered before the God who is willing to forgive us. We are gathered before the God who has made provision for our salvation. And so we come and we commit our time, we commit our energy before you and pray that as we gather, that we may honour our God and grow in our faith. In Jesus' name, amen. When we get into religious conversation, there are sometimes things that are deemed to be inappropriate or things that are embarrassing or a wee bit awkward to talk about. And in some ways, Genesis 38 can be seen as one of those chapters and one of those parts of the Bible that are a bit embarrassing and awkward. So it's no surprise then that apparently Genesis 38, it ranks amongst the least preached on chapters in the Bible. And yet this chapter helps to lay the foundation of hope for many people and families and announces to us the family that God has chosen for the birth of the Messiah. The family was not chosen, as we're discovering, for their good works. The family was chosen because God wanted to. This chapter is another reminder that there are no limits to those whom God can bring to saving faith, whom God can work through to bring about his wonderful and perfect plan of salvation. Last week we learnt about the strong-willed Judah and how he steamrolled over his family for his own ends. We now see that Judah has suffered the loss of his wife, and then he sleeps with a woman who he believes to be a prostitute. So one of the oldest professions in the world makes an appearance in the first book of the Bible. And some people would say, well, it's not appropriate to talk about people or to talk about things like that in a church service. And yet in terms of salvation history, in terms of salvation, in terms of hope, it is appropriate because we are talking about the family line of Jesus Christ. We often read about this relative of Joseph called Tamar at Christmas. We read about her in the Gospel of Matthew as we think about the genealogy of Jesus Christ, and we never bat an eyelid. And so here we have this tricky lady called Tamar who appears in the genealogy of our Saviour Jesus Christ. And so it is worthwhile exploring her and the family circle of Joseph. Judah had sinned in ways that would make us blush and which indeed we would struggle to talk about. Yet Almighty God chose Judah to be the family line, as we said, which would provide a powerful line of kings. And God chose Judah to become a nation in its own right. And God chose Judah's line to bear the Saviour of the world in the flesh. And yet, in these first encounters with Judah, there's no sign that any of these things could possibly come from such a strong-willed, rebellious and immoral family as this. God must have made a mistake. He must have got the 12 brothers mixed up somehow, and surely he meant to choose Joseph. Like, Joseph was a cleaner living, better standard of man than Judah. He must have meant him. But no, God was clear he had chosen Judah for this specific purpose. And maybe there was a stage whenever it would never have crossed your mind to think about God. Maybe there was a stage whenever you weren't interested in the things of God and his salvation. And now here you are, you're listening to God's word, God's message. It's a reminder that people can change. And Judah is an encouragement to you that things, no matter how bad or sinful were in the past, can be different now and in the future. Maybe you've never had time for God before, but just as Judah changed, you too can be changed. That change was partly brought about by a woman that was used by God. And the woman that was used by God to transform Judah was not his wife, the daughter of Shua, It was rather his daughter-in-law called Tamar. Judah's marriage, as we learnt from last week, produced three sons. The eldest son was called Er, and he married this young woman called Tamar. But Judah's eldest son, we understand from Genesis 38 and verse 7, he was wicked in the sight of the Lord, and so the Lord God put him to death. Judah promised Tamar a child by one of his other sons, but the second son, Onan, refused, and God also put him to death. And so the wickedness of Judah's two oldest sons did not reflect well upon his role as father. It didn't reflect well on his parenting skills and bringing up his children in a godly manner. Not only was Judah strong-willed, but it turns out that his children were also very rebellious in life. Since two sons, as far as Judah could see it, had died with Tamar, he was reluctant to lose a third by giving over his youngest son, Shelah, to be husband to Tamar. So Tamar came to the conclusion that Judah had really no intention of giving Shelah to her to produce children. Her conclusion was that if she were to bear children to carry on the family name of Er, she was resigned to the fact that she was the one that must force the issue. She must do something to make it happen. Now, as we read about Tamar, we could very well have some sympathy with her situation. As we finished off last week, we reminded ourselves that she was cut off from Judah's family. She was sent back to live with her father. And so she was cut off from having offspring. She was cut off from financial support. And her biological clock was still ticking. Is it any wonder that this woman then decides that she needs to take matters into her own hands to provide for her own welfare? Well, regarding Judah, his wife has died, and a considerable time has actually passed. And now Judah has pulled himself together and he's decided that he'll take a walk up to see the sheep shearers at Timnah with Hira the Adullamite. Someone had tipped off Tamar that her father-in-law was going up to Timnah to where the sheep shearers were at work. So Tamar's plan was to remove her widow's garments and to cover herself with a veil and sit in the gateway of a place called Enaim, which is on the road to Timnah. Tamar planned to put herself out as a prostitute on the roadside to trick her father-in-law Judah, because by now she could see that Shelah should have been given to her as a husband. Now, if you stop and think about it, legally, Tamar was regarded as the wife of Shelah, but the marriage was never actually consummated. And in some ways, as we think about this story, there is a reminder of how Rebekah and Jacob took things into their own hands to trick Isaac to giving Esau's blessing to Jacob. Verse 15, we get the picture that Judah comes dandering down the road. He recognizes this woman to be a prostitute. She had her face covered, so she had on the gear that was associated with a prostitute. And back in verse 2 of last week's reading, we know that Judah picked his wife based on her appearance. We would say he had an eye for the women. And in verse 16, we see here that when he came along the road, he went over to her. So he made an effort to go over to meet this woman by the roadside and said, "Come now, let me sleep with you." Now, he knew it was a prostitute, but he didn't realize that it was his daughter-in-law, Tamar. In Judah's mind, he was going to have a sexual relationship with a prostitute. And it would appear from Judah, it wasn't the first time that he had dealings with people like this before. Tamar, she knew Judah very well from the time that she had lived around him, from the time that she had been there as part of that family. She knew the shortcuts. She knew how she could trick him. Moral purity doesn't appear to have been one of Judah's virtues. And he doesn't seem to show any sort of naivety when it comes to dealing with prostitutes. He handled the arrangements with an experienced mind. He knew what he had to do and he knew what he was doing. Tamar was convinced that if she could only look like a prostitute, Judah would be tricked into taking things from there. And her goal, and what was ultimately Judah's goal at the very start, would be achieved if she fell pregnant. And yet, as we read through this, as pages of the Bible, and think about this story, what a strange way for Tamar to obtain what was legally and rightfully hers in the first place. It was legal and right for her to have a child, but she seemed to be going about it in an awful awkward way. Well, we have to think back that in Tamar's society, not only were the younger brothers able by law to raise up seed to her husband, after all, Judah had sent the brother, Onan, because Er had died. Onan came and there was no offspring to that. And we see there that principle being put into place. Sheila was still being waited for, but also her father-in-law, by the regulations, could raise up a seed for her dead husband. In this case, Judah lawfully could have born children with Tamar. Now, that would be grossly offensive to us in our culture, but that's how it was back then in that stage in Genesis. So Tamar, she was determined to force the matter. She was determined to become pregnant by Judah, to have offspring, to have financial support by children to look after in her old age. Judah was wrong. He was wrong to withhold Sheila. But so was Tamar by taking things into her own hands. And so, yep, we could argue that Tamar had done nothing wrong by sleeping with Judah. But what was wrong was her method of doing so. So as part of that roadside encounter, Judah negotiated a price with her that was acceptable for both parties. Now, it was probably common practice to ask for some kind of pledge, since little could be done to force the client as such to pay after the act. Judah, well, he expected Tamar to insist on some form of guarantee. That would only have been natural. And so the pledge was given that would serve to prove at a later time that Judah was the father of the child that was conceived through this union. Judah, he agreed to send a kid from his flock, as we see in verse 17. And whenever you stop and think about that, it involves a kid from the flock. Well, it was goat hair that was used to deceive Isaac to give the blessing to Jacob. It was goat's blood that was used to make Jacob think that Joseph was dead. And now a goat was going to be the price of Tamar's trick. In the meantime, Tamar asked Judah for a pledge until the goat would be delivered. Tamar asked for a seal, cord, and staff. And so Judah willingly gave them across to her and went into her and conceived a child through that intercourse. Then Tamar, she arose, she departed, she removed all her veil, and she went back to putting on her widow's garments. Life as such appeared to go back to normal, both for her and for Judah. When this encounter ended, they both had went their separate ways. And Judah went off to the sheep shears and all the rest and about his business. And he never actually knew the identity of this prostitute. Tamar, she went back to living as a widow in her father's house. And normally, such an affair would have been quickly forgotten, just as it would be today. But several events occurred which made this immoral interlude a nightmare that Judah would never be able to put out of his mind. In the case of Judah, this was a sinful act. It was a sexual relationship outside of marriage. And when we sin against God, and we sin against each other. And nothing that is done in secret stays in secret. Sin has a wonderful way of leaking, like oil leaking onto the road. And we know that, as we've seen in the recent week in the newspaper or in Facebook, oil spilt out on one of the streets in Rathfriland. And they were warning the traffic to watch out because it was slippery and it could cause an accident. And so often in life, sin is like that. It can go on to cause further accidents, pain and agony. What Judah did was wrong. And the same is still true for us today. Sexual relationships outside of marriage are against God's will and plan. But the good news is that if that has happened to us, God is willing and God can forgive us for those sins if we are willing to repent of them and ask for his forgiveness. Just as a good Presbyterian may find this chapter difficult to deal with, so do good Israelites. No Israelite can take this record seriously without a deep sense of humility at what happened in the line of Judah. And remember that Judah is Israel's roots. And if you can forgive me, we could say that Israel's roots were smothered in sin. The people of Israel, they could not look back upon their ancestry with any feelings of smugness and pride. They couldn't look back and say, what a great fella Judah was. They couldn't look back and say, look at our family. They were a really high-standing, honourable people. No wonder God chose them. But no, when they looked back, they basically had to look back in shame. There were too many skeletons in the cupboard for them to be able to look back with pride. Instead, they had to acknowledge that whatever good had come to Israel, it had come as a result of the grace of Almighty God. The Lord didn't set his love on you, nor choose you or choose me because of what we've done. The Lord God didn't choose Judah for what they had done. He chose them and he's chosen us because it is his will and it's his plan. And so this morning, it is good for all of us to remember that we shouldn't be smug about our faith. If we have come to saving faith in Jesus Christ, we shouldn't be smug about our faith and think because we've been good. No, we should realize and remember it is because God has chosen us. Then this morning, if you're an unbeliever, can I say, don't be put off today by the sin in your life, whatever form that has taken in the past. Can you be reassured that God offers you forgiveness? Indeed, God offers you a new life. He offers you the opportunity to be born again. I trust that whatever your background, whatever your circumstances, whatever your relationships in the past or the present, I trust that you would feel at home in the ministry and in the fellowship of this congregation of First Rathfriland Presbyterian Church. And I trust that as we go forward week by week, that we may encourage each other, that we may build each other up, and that we may come to a deeper understanding about how God chooses people despite the sin and despite the things that have happened in the past. But God chooses people and calls us to repentance and to depend upon Him because of what He has done, not because of what we have done. Amen. Let's come and pray for those in our congregation and in our nation. Father God, we come and avail of the invitation to come to you in prayer this morning. As we come, Lord God, we want to pray for families who struggle with relational issues inside or outside of marriage. Lord, we pray for their encouragement. We pray, Lord, that they may find strength and guidance in you. And Lord, that they may take comfort and find hope through this story of Judah and Tamar. Lord God, we want to remember and pray for those in our congregation who are ill, whether at home or in hospital or in residential care. We also, Lord, want to bear before you those who care for their loved ones and ask that you would grant them health and strength to care and to undertake the duties that are placed upon them. Father, as we come before you, we're thankful again for an easing of lockdown and for the process of coming out of national hibernation. We pray, Lord God, that you would guide those in government, those who set the rules, and in turn then that you would guide all of us in obeying the rules for the health of ourselves and of our neighbours. Lord God, we come this day and we pray for our Kirk session here in First Rathfriland as they discuss the process of getting church reopened on Sunday the 16th of August. Lord, we pray that you would grant them wisdom, guidance and understanding as they make their way through the different regulations and the different expectations so that people may once again, where able, be able to worship content and an understanding that they are safe. Lord, we also want to pray for our local schools and for the boards of governors as they discuss how to get staff and children safely back to school again. Lord, as with churches, there are many hurdles to be overcome. And so we pray, Lord, that at this stressful and pressurized time for teachers and principals, that you would grant them wisdom and strength, Lord. And so, Father God, we pray these things through the name of Jesus, our Lord and Saviour. Amen. This morning, for our words of praise, we turn to the well-known words, Amazing Grace.
Relieved, how precious. that grace appear, the I first believed. My chains are gone, I've been set free. My God, my Savior has ransomed me. And like a flood, His mercy rains, unending love, amazing grace. The Lord has promised.
Let's come and close in prayer. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we know that you have knit us together as your chosen family. You have brought us into one communion and one fellowship in the body of your precious Son, Jesus Christ. We pray today that you would help us to lead a life worthy of the calling to which we have been called. And so in the name of God, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, we ask that you would enable us to bear witness to the truth, now and forevermore. Amen.
My ransom, why should I gain? Why should I gain from His reward? I cannot give an answer, but this I know with all my heart, His wounds that paid my ransom. Paid my rent.